Often, during times of storms and affliction, it is difficult to distinguish between Christians and others, because sometimes we assume the same attitudes of anxiety, fear, desperation, when truly this is when we should mark a difference. Do you act differently in the middle of a crisis, knowing that God has control? Good morning, I am Pastor Carlos Rios, and this is our devotional Manha, a daily adventure with God. Today we arrive to chapter 28 in the book of Acts. I believe that we as Christians and as God's children should behave in a different way compared to others. We should be distinguished from others because a storm is almost as a crossroad. Some take the correct path, but others continue down the path that leads to death, says the Bible. Crisis will always reveal who we are. Crisis always separates the triumphant and the cowardly. From the wounds of crisis surge the greatest leaders. And this is what the text is saying. Let's look at verses 1 and 2 of Acts chapter 28. If you recall, yesterday we ended up saying that they arrived on an island. They arrived on the island of Malta. It was raining and cold. The inhabitants took care of those who were on board, the 276 prisoners. The Bible tells us that they were very kind to them, lighting a bonfire. During storms, it is necessary to fight for our life because it is worthless to just complain about the crisis, to become discouraged and stop fighting. It is worthless to become desperate or rebel against God. There are people who, when it's time to begin the fight, during trying times, they separate themselves from the light, harden their hearts to God, and join those who are bitter, complaining, and the battle becomes even more difficult. During a storm, we must learn to turn to God, to keep our hearts lit, to not give up, and above all, allowing God to speak to my heart. I know that many of you may be going through situations that perhaps it seems as if no one understands. When a child loses his mother or father, I know this causes a huge impact to their faith, and perhaps they end up saying, why did God take my mother or father when I needed them the most? And there are moments when we will not understand, but what we must understand is that God's will is good and perfect, and that there are things that perhaps we do not understand at the moment, but we will later. That often it is not God who takes from us, but the fallen world that we live in, that is based in a series of disadjustments and circumstances that lead to people losing their lives. This is the truth. And so when I approach the bonfire during a time of storm, I must know that I need this fire. And this is what this group of people did as soon as they onboarded the ship, as they trembled in the cold after many days in a storm where they had no source of heat or anything dry to keep them warm. And here they were. What's the condition of your soul and your heart during crisis? Many have gone cold. I know many Christians who have allowed their hearts to become cold. Many Christians who have lost the faith, the hope. Come close to the bonfire. Allow the Holy Spirit to warm up your life again. Do not continue wasting your time with the same things. Instead, approach God. Receive encouragement, new strengths. And I know that God each day will give you more sense of purpose, more sense of living in what you do. In the same chapter 28, now let's read verse 3. And you'll notice that the first thing they did was to approach the bonfire to feel the warmth, because they needed it. Then it says that the centurion, the mariners, and the prisoners were all enjoying the warmth of the fire. They were only thinking about resolving their immediate problem, but did nothing to keep the fire going. Paul, however, went to find wood to throw into the fire. He said, I'm going to help. I'm going to gather more wood for the fire. And this is similar to when we in life learn to make investments for the future. If you have a lamp that works with oil, then you mustn't just think of the lamp but also on the oil. You must think about the fuel that feeds the flame to keep you warm. Do you know why so many are tired, consumed, stressed? Because everyone demands from you. Those women who are listening to me this morning, those who are mothers, their children demand from them. Those who are wives, their husbands demand from them. Those who are employees, their bosses demand from them. And the same thing with men. Everyone is asking us for things, demanding that we give. But I'm going to ask all of you a question this morning. You who are always giving, those of you who people demand and demand from, who gives you? Where do you receive sustainment, nourishment from? And so if you do not want to become consumed, if you do not want your battery, your fuel to run out, if you do not want to end up dried, consumed in life, then there must be a daily nourishment that sustains your heart. This is why manna arrives each morning to your life as spiritual nourishment, as something that sustains, that gives new strengths, that revitalizes, that fills the heart. And this is why this must not be an option. If I become consumed after a day filled with stress, with work, things that demand from me, then I must find a way to be prepared. This is why if you go to a doctor or a nutritionist, he or she says, well, if you are a person who travels often or live a busy life, take these vitamins, these proteins, make sure you eat well, balanced. This makes sense. And the same thing occurs at a spiritual level. I believe people go around consumed, stressed, tired, and frustrated for this reason. Because we give, and we give, but we receive very little. And God has a source of living water for you. He has a source of spiritual nourishment for you. The Bible will always be a great storehouse for you to go to fill your heart with God, with His presence, and what your life needs each day. Let's move on to verse 13. I'm reading Acts chapter 28. Verse 3. While trying to help and keep everybody warm, a serpent appeared. It says that as Paul was throwing the brushwood into the fire, a viper fastened itself on his hand. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, "This man must be a murderer, for though he escaped from the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live." This is what the locals said. Without knowing it, they were revealing Paul's past, because in fact, Paul had been a man who persecuted the church, who ordered the death of many Christians. He was a faithful and cruel persecutor of the church. Do you recall when Stephen was stoned? Well, they received the order from Paul, who was a Roman. And I believe that sometimes the devil comes to remind us of our past. But when the devil reminds us of our past, remind him about your future, because your past was already resolved on the cross. There, our sins were canceled. But the future of the devil is the lake of fire, where he will be tormented for eternity. And so this will happen. The snakes will come out to tell you are guilty, that everything that is happening is your fault. Well, I think it is good that God comes to speak to us so that we repent and are forgiven, but we mustn't fall into a guilty complex because Christ already died for our sins. In fact, let's look at what Paul does in verse 5. Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. He was unaffected by the poison, by the venom, and this is what the Bible calls us to do, to take up the shield of faith, to quench the fire from the darts of the enemy. And this is why I ask you, do not open doors in your life for the enemy, because the devil is an expert in poisoning. God's word says the devil is the ancient serpent. The Bible tells us that by nature, he is a liar, deceitful, and you and I must cast out of our lives all these things, the consequences of our past life. I find it very sad when people who are going through a storm, a situation, but their heart is still filled with bitterness, resentment, with pain. Because if God allows us to go through what we are going through, it is precisely so that we remove these things from our heart, not for these things to become entrenched. And this is why we mentioned yesterday Do not attempt to seek who is guilty, because it is not about who is guilty or pointing fingers or asking, why am I here? Why am I going through this? Or finding who is responsible. Instead, behind all of this, allow crisis, allow the storms, instead to give me the opportunity to say, well, I must ask God for forgiveness. I have to let go of what is holding me down. During this great storm, what did all these people who were on the boat have to do? They were forced to throw everything overboard. They had no time to think, oh, I need this, so that's our food, that's our clothing, what am I going to wear tomorrow? None of their lives were at risk, and the last thing on their minds was to save material things or any of their belongings. No, they casted everything overboard. And this is what it's about. I believe that during times of storms, I think what God wants us to do is to get rid of all those unnecessary things, or even the things that we believe are valuable, the things we think are important. But that's not true. Often what we store in our hearts are antiques or things that are not helpful for us. And so Paul himself also had to throw everything he owned overboard. But also, in this event with the snake, he did not allow the snake to stay fastened on his arm or the poison to penetrate his body and his heart. Do not allow comments, gossip, or the voices of others to poison your heart. You and I were called to receive blessing and to give blessing. Do not allow curses in your life, nor should you curse anyone, because we, as God's children, were called to inherit and to be blessing wherever we go. And so this means that our life must become a source of healing, of blessing for those who need it, for people who are in need. So glory to God, because the storm that you are going through is leading us to this, to understand that God wants a clean heart, a heart that is not loaded down, bogged down. God does not want you looking back, remorseful of the past, with a guilty complex that pesters us and holds us down. No, instead, from here on out, we have a new life in Christ. If you are receiving what God is telling you, write to us through our YouTube channel. Answer the following question: how much poison do we allow in our lives? Why do we allow the comments of other people to make our hearts bitter? Write to us and we will be glad to listen to your comments and respond, knowing that each day God has things to teach us and to speak to our hearts. What storm are you going through? Has God given you everything you need to come out of the storm? I believe he has, but we must be calm, knowing that God has a great message for us today. Send this devotional audio to that person you know needs it, to that person who is going through a great storm, and say to them, God is your lifesaver, and he wants you to listen to this message that will change your heart. Pray with me. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the beginning of this new day. I ask you in the name of Jesus to take our heart. We have the longing and the desire for you. We approach you after many days of loneliness, of emptiness, of being cold. We now approach the bonfire. We approach so God can bring warmth to our heart, for the Holy Spirit to bring fire to our lives. Lord, drive out the cold in the hearts of many Christians, of God's children, and allow the Holy Spirit to place fire in our hearts. And that through this fire, Lord, each day in the warmth, we can help and serve other hearts that are thirsty for you. I give you this day. I ask that you go in front of us, that you guard us, and that your presence each day be upon the hearts of each one of us. In Christ Jesus, amen and amen, and I await for you tomorrow. Blessings to all.